Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmond speaks to Emily Oster, a Brown University economist and bestselling author, about her efforts to explain COVID and its risks to people in simple and understandable bites. Let's listen.
Emily Oster, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
So I want to start with sort of a possibly obvious question, which is, so you're an economics professor, and you are definitely studying these days, writing these days about COVID, and not necessarily the economic impacts of COVID. So talk to me about sort of how you got here.
And so so I am an economics professor, but I have a sideline in writing about parenting and childbirth. So I have two books about using data in pregnancy and early parenting. And so I had started, I have a newsletter in which I talk about the stuff from those books. And then when the pandemic hit, I started talking more and more about COVID and around the issues that parents were thinking about with their kids and what does the data say about COVID. And so I've sort of moved into doing much more of that. I've actually gotten pretty involved in my university's response to the pandemic. And then I got involved in working with some doctors to try to do some translational discussions in which we try to help people understand some of the virology. So I sort of went all in on a bunch of this stuff, even though it isn't really the economics of COVID, which I actually don't really know anything about, to be honest.
So you got together with these folks and now you have a website. Talk to me about that.
Yes, we have a website. It's called explaincovid.org or covidexplains.org. You can get to it in a variety of ways. And our goal with that is really to help people understand more about the basics of the virus. So when we started this, I think our kind of big reaction was that a lot of people just really fundamentally didn't understand, like, how do I get the virus? And I think without that understanding, it's hard to think about why would masks work or why would hand washing work? And helping people see that the reason hand washing works is even if you get virus particles on your hand, even if somebody coughs on your hand, they have the virus, then if you wash it off before you touch your face, then the virus particles don't get in. And so I think a lot of our initial efforts were really helping people understand those basics. And so we have some sort of long form explainers about that, about how treatment works, trying to demystify a little bit. And lately, we've been covering more and more about parenting and kids and how people think about that, because that's where I think a lot of people have gone now, sort of trying to understand how they can navigate this with their families, at least a lot of people who are reading the stuff that we're writing.
Mm-hmm. So what's sort of the biggest question that folks who are reading your work, what are they asking?
I think they're now asking a lot about safe reopening, and that's become particularly fraught in the last few weeks as we've seen, well, maybe we reopened a little too soon in some places. And so I think people really want to understand what is okay to do and what's not okay to do. Is it okay to go to an indoor restaurant? Like, how can I do that safely? How should I think about seeing my elderly parents? How should I think about childcare for my kid? So I think there are a lot of questions around sort of like re-entering the world and how we can do that safely. And that's what we're getting a lot of.
Mm-hmm. And what are you telling people? I mean, what's sort of your special sauce that you bring to it?
So I think a lot of what I at least am telling people is trying to give them some guidance about how to think about some of those choices, and particularly around the family choices. So how to kind of structure some of those decisions and what are the considerations you want to put in. And I think that both the website and the other writing that I'm doing, a lot of it is about like making sure that you think about what is right for your personal situation. And I think it's very hard in this space to say, this is the right choice. Like, it's definitely right to send your kid to daycare, or it's definitely not right to send your kid to daycare, or, it's definitely right to see your parents or not see your parents. or definitely ready to go grocery shopping. I think we really need to help people make those choices in a way that is kind of comfortable for them. And that's something that I try to do in all kinds of parts of parenting, but I think it's particularly central here where everybody's considerations are really, really different.
Mm-hmm. So talk to me about childcare. I know you've done a little bit of research, maybe a little unscientific research about childcare.
Yeah. So one of the huge things that comes up is just, you know, to what extent is COVID transmitting around daycare centers? And one of the things early on that I kept just expecting is there to be some data coming out from childcare settings, which have been open during the pandemic. So one of the things people don't realize is even in places like New York, like places that were really heavily affected, there were childcare settings. There are childcare settings that remain open the whole time. They serve the children of essential workers. They serve, you know, there's just places that have been open. That is a key source of information for what is going to happen if, as we reopen other childcare settings. And so I kept waiting and waiting and waiting for the data on those to come out and telling people, okay, I can't wait for that data to come out. And then it's just like never did. And so at some point I got so like, I'm almost frustrated is probably the right word. I sort of like upset about this. That we started doing sort of like a, as you say, sort of unscientific, basically Google Doc survey of places that have been open during the pandemic and just crowdsourced a bunch of data. And, you know, I am in some ways a little uncomfortable with this because as an academic, like that isn't the way I would like to collect my sample. And I see it a little bit as proof of concept, you know, through some networks of daycares and through Twitter, you know, we've got a sample that covers like 1,000 childcare settings of 30,000 kids where we can look at just some basic summary statistics. Now that's not a random sample. There's a lot of problems, but it does show that like this information is available. And I think we should be pushing to get more and more of that, but we do have some of that put up on our site now.
And what did you find?
We find is that the rates among kids in these places are very low. So, you know, something like 0.2% of the kids who were reported on have, you know, recognized confirmed COVID cases. The rates among staff are higher, more like 1% of the staff. And so that lines up in general with what we'd expect for older people versus kids in the kind of relative COVID rates. We're now doing a little bit of tracking, and so I'm hoping we'll be able to do even more to sort of look at, you know, if there's one case, do we then in the next week see 10 cases, or is this more like there's an isolated case and then it doesn't seem to spread around the daycare? So I think that's actually a pretty important piece of information.
Mm-hmm. And I guess we have seen now some research that came out that showed very similar data to what you found.
Yeah. So I think increasingly we're sort of seeing that type of data coming out and also seeing it out of Europe, you know, out of what has happened when they did reopen the schools. We haven't seen a lot of, it's not that we haven't seen any cases in schools. You've seen cases in schools. We haven't seen like big outbreaks in schools. So I think the data is kind of coalescing around that broad conclusion that schools are probably not a huge source of spread.
And I imagine in childcare settings, it's really hard, really, really hard to socially distance. These kids are probably not wearing masks. So this isn't even sort of an ideal culture of everyone's wearing a mask, they're staying apart. They're not like hugging and kissing each other because that's what kids that age do, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So I think, on the one hand, I think that's exactly right. That like, these are childcare settings where it's unlikely that, you cannot keep 4-year-olds from touching each other. You just can't. If you're running a childcare setting for babies, you got to change their diaper. There's all kinds of other stuff. What I think is true is that these tend to be small kids. Mm-hmm. And so as we think about reopening schools, we know that say high school students are at higher risk of the virus than 3-year-olds. And so I think that piece of it, sort of thinking about, we probably don't want to learn from 3-year-olds about high schools. And so we want, when we open high schools, we're going to probably also want to keep thinking about, you know, masks and distancing, which is easier in 17-year-olds. I mean, you know, well, it's easier for them to understand that they should do it. Whether they will do it is a different question, but it's easier to understand that than with 3-year-olds. So I think we're going to have to kind of be thoughtful about how we put these pieces of information together.
Mm-hmm. So you found that childcare data was missing. What else do you really want to know that you don't find that we're really getting?
I mean, everything. I feel like in general, our tracking is very poor. And I think early on, a lot of academics were pushing for like, why aren't we doing more random testing? Why aren't we doing more random sampling and testing of everybody? And I still think we should do that. But that is seems like a becoming like even more of a fantasy than it was before. And I don't think we're ever going to get there. And I think somehow focusing on that, I'm worried has led us to not think about some of the things we could do, some of the like less serious, like less intense things, just basic tracking. So I would like to see more of that. I just am not, I'm becoming less, more pessimistic, angry. I don't know, maybe angry is the wrong word.
Well, how should, why is it so hard to navigate this? You know, it's a, you know, it's an illness and we're learning, I guess we're learning more every day, but why are people so, why is there so much confusion out there?
Yeah, I think that that partly it's just the incredible amount of uncertainty that that is making it hard for people to process this. And I think it has also, for a lot of people, really tapped into some very deep fears. You know, and I think that there, of course, there are reasons why, you know, we've seen a tremendous amount of death from this, much more than you see from the flu or something. And so I think that, that you know, there's reasons to be afraid, but I think it is, it has prompted some fears in people that are probably beyond the kind of reasonable level, given how risky this is, at least for particular groups. I also think there is an issue of salience. So, you know, when we are thinking about this all the time, particularly when we're like home and we're in our, like, we can't leave our house. Like, people were just like thinking about this all the time, all the time, all the time. And I think that that meant that every piece of information you were like digging into and focusing on in a way that, that doesn't happen normally. And so I, you know, people sometimes have asked me about kid stuff. And there was a period where we kind of came out with, there was a, was became clear that a very small number of kids can get very sick. Probably after, so sort of several weeks after infection. And, you know, people were like, oh my God, we have to change everything we're doing because of this. And it was like, you know, if we reported on every kid who died of the flu, you would have a different, you would feel differently about that also. And so I think that there really is a sort of like attention and salience piece of this that's important.
Mm-hmm. Is there any piece on your website that's been like the most popular piece that you really hear the most about?
I think the thing we hear the most about is this, we have like a path of the virus explainer, which I think is the thing that gets the most attention because it is just like, this is how this works. This is how you can be exposed. This is like where the, how the virus works. This is what a virus is. Like, here is what it does to you. I think in some ways that demystifies for people. Like, you sort of see this, like we're not all in like high school biology anymore, apparently. And so, you know, just having somebody explain, okay, this is how it works, I think is a way to combat some of the fear. So you're like, okay, I get this. Like, this is a virus. It's like other viruses. My body has thought about how to address this. Here's how it works. So that's the piece I think we get the most read on.
Mm-hmm. And I think getting people to sort of really understand in a simple way, science again, as you said, we're not all in AP biology anymore.
Yeah, no, it was actually, it's been super, super interesting for me. Even, you know, I think of myself as somebody who knows something about science, but as you pointed out at the beginning, I'm an economist. and so when we start like write people, you know, there's a lot of science people on this team and, you know, they're writing about vaccines and I've learned all kinds of interesting stuff about how we make vaccines and the different like new technologies for making vaccines and why this might be faster than other options. So that's been really interesting.
And what do you expect to do or want to do going forward with this?
So people always ask, like, what is your like long-term hope for this website? My long-term hope for this website is that I shut it down because I'm hoping that this will end. But, you know, I would like to, you know, I think we will keep trying to provide useful content, particularly around the kids and schools and so on, as the kind of summer progresses and as we get into the fall. I think it's very, very unlikely that there will be vanishingly impossible that there would be a vaccine by the fall. And so we're going to be dealing with these things. So in the long term, we're just hoping to keep helping people navigate some of these choices.
And so should we go back to school in the fall?
I mean, I think it's, I think we should be trying. That's my current line. Basically, I think we should be doing everything we can to see how we can make the logistics work. My concerns lie with not the kids, but with the teachers and the staff and people who work in the cafeteria and the janitorial staff and all of the other people who are around schools, not really with the kids. I think we need to figure out what are the ways we can protect those groups. And how can we be creative about which of those people are working and who's, you know, has somebody filling in for them in a way that protects that that population? I think that's going to be the key to figuring this out.
Emily Oster, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.